Most people stare up into space with wonder. Yet we have this almost alien world on our own planet, just teeming with life. It's a world completely out of sight and out of mind.
I have the utmost respect for corals. They're really sophisticated animals.
Coral is a fundamental part of a huge ecosystem.
They continue living as long as their environment allows them to.
There's this big heat wave that's traveling around all over the world. The coral bleaches, and what you're seeing is its skeleton underneath. It's like your body temperature changing. That's the seriousness of the issue. So we're sending two teams to put cameras down and capture this bleaching event.
The wind and the storm is really the controlling factor right now.
The wind just took us. The stern anchor didn't hold.
It's just demolished.
You're working in an environment every single day that humans weren't built for. Your body is cut up.
And then you open your eyes. And it's dead as far as you can see.
We don't have any time to waste if we want to have any hope.
We live at a unique moment in time where we can change history. It's not too late for coral reefs.
This has got to wake up the world.
Welcome to the Aaron Harber Show. My guest today, Jeff Orlowski, who is the director, producer, creator of not only Chasing Ice, but Chasing Coral. Jeff, thanks for joining me.
Thank you so much for being here.
Hey, my pleasure. It's great having you here. Incredible movie. Everyone just saw the trailer, of course. But let's start off with Chasing Ice. What did you learn from doing Chasing Ice that allowed you to do a better job on Chasing Coral?
Well, Chasing Ice was my first feature film. In college, I did some shorts, but that was the first big project. It was, in many ways, I think of it as my own film school. And so through that process of years of learning how to shoot, how to tell a story, how to edit, we went into Chasing Coral with that much more experience and that much more know-how. So when we started the project, I personally feel like it was more cohesive of a vision, more directed from the beginning. Yeah.
And how did Chasing Coral come about?
Yeah. I got an email out of the blue from a guy named Richard Vevers, who he's from Australia, and he invented this camera that could do underwater 360-degree images. And this is a few years ago, several years ago. He invented this camera that is basically all of Google Street View underwater. You can go onto Google Maps right now, and you can go on a virtual dive. You can type in Great Barrier Reef, and you can go on a dive underwater through Street View through this camera that Richard built. So in working, meeting Richard, meeting his team, learning what was going on, we saw that the oceans were changing and that there was a story happening literally beneath the surface that nobody could see, nobody could know about unless you were out there.
One of the really interesting aspects, challenging aspects of all this is the fact that because coral is underwater, people really don't see it as a matter of their daily routine. They don't know much about it. So talk about what coral is and the challenge of the fact that it's underwater.
Yeah. Along your point, less than 1% of the world population goes scuba diving. So it's a very unseen story. Coral reefs are, in some ways, they're the nursery of the ocean. It's estimated about 25% of all fish species in the ocean spend part of their life cycle on a coral reef. So they are, coral is an animal. It's a really amazing thing. It's an animal.
And most people think it's a plant,
it looks,
probably.
Yeah, well, it's an animal that has plants living in its flesh that makes a rock as a byproduct. So it's really incredible. It's a fleshy animal. Picture like the skin around my bones. Like that's the animal. And within the skin, within that flesh of the animal, there are these tiny plants that photosynthesize. They collect energy from the sun and they create food for the animal. And as that animal grows, it makes a skeleton. It deposits this rock and gets larger and larger and larger. Now, the cool thing about it is that as it branches out, just picture a tree branch, you know, all these forks every so often, many corals do that as well. And these branching patterns create structure and create effectively like buildings for small fish and for small creatures to live within them. So the coral is the backbone of a coral reef. They are literally creating the entire structure that all of these countless organisms, fish, sea cucumbers, shrimps, sharks, everything is living in and around and amongst this city created by these corals.
And some of the cities are pretty big.
The Great Barrier Reef is massive. It's the length of the eastern seaboard of the United States. Belize has a huge reef as well. The reefs off of Florida and the Caribbean can be seen from space as well, not just the Great Barrier Reef. These are the largest structures made by creatures on the planet.
Yeah, and you can see them from outer space.
Yeah.
Pretty amazing. Okay. How do coral reefs, how does coral die? And why is coral dying?
So there are a lot of things that can kill a coral. I mean, it is another animal. There are many different things that can stress it out. Corals have adapted over a long, long period of time to live in these certain parts of the planet that are optimized for them. They live in really clear water. They live in warm conditions. They live very close to the upper temperature threshold. So if they can survive a certain temperature range, they live as close as they can to that edge. That's how they thrive really, really well. We're finding corals dying right now from a number of factors, the biggest one being temperature, being ocean temperature. The water is just literally getting too hot, such that the corals can't survive those temperatures anymore.
What type of time frame is needed for coral to adapt to rising temperatures?
To adapt as in if they were to survive higher temperatures? That's a really good question. There's no easy answer to that. I think the scientists right now are actively studying, can we breed corals to survive higher temperatures? We know that different corals on different parts of the planet can sustain different temperatures. So the temperatures of corals in the Red Sea, those corals live at higher temperatures than in the Caribbean or in Australia, for example. So over time, those corals have adapted to different temperature zones. But the scientists are not very hopeful that we're not expecting corals to be able to adapt to the changes in the oceans. The changes are just happening too fast for these animals to evolve that quickly.
Right. If
they're just dying. That's the unfortunate thing right now.
All right. When we come back, I want to talk about the rate at which they're dying and where they're dying and what the implications are.
Yeah.
So we'll be back to talk more about chasing coral with Jeff in just a moment.
Join me and watch the Aaron Harber Show.
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 I'm Reverend Jesse Jackson. Watch the Aaron Harber Show and keep hope alive.
I'm Aaron Harber, host of the Aaron Harber Show. Find us on Facebook to get all the latest updates, see behind-the-scenes photos, and make comments and ask me questions. You can see episodes before their TV broadcast, so like the show today.
The Rex Howe Broadcaster of the Year Award recognizes an individual who, through leadership, skill, and dedication, is advancing the broadcast industry in our state and our nation. Tonight, we honor Aaron Harber. Aaron has worked extensively in the media as a host, producer, political and economic commentator, and columnist. Today, the Aaron Harber Show is the focus of his media involvement. Aaron, it is a privilege to present you with the Rex Howe Broadcaster of the Year Award. Congratulations.
Just make journalism great again. I'm Aaron Harber, host of the Aaron Harber Show. You can follow the show on Twitter for instant notification of new episodes, live event invitations, outtakes, and behind-the-scenes photos. And tweet us your topic and guest suggestions today. Welcome back to the show. We're talking with Jeff Orlowski, who created chasing coral. So, Jeff, we were talking about the fact that coral is dying. Talk a little bit more about the temperature issue. I think a lot of people don't realize that simply a 2 degree centigrade increase in temperature can have devastating effects on coral. So talk about that, and talk about how that relates to the human body if we went up 2 degrees centigrade.
So coral lives in this very sweet zone. It's the Goldilocks for temperature for coral.
Sweet spot.
There is a sweet spot. And in the summertime, scientists started to discover this a couple decades ago in the 80s. And during an El Nino, the water got particularly hot. And the coral started turning white for some reason. And they started testing it. And we've seen it now a number of times. If you push a coral past a certain temperature threshold, and it's about 1.8 to 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you push coral above that temperature zone for a couple of weeks, they'll start turning white. And if it stays like that for too long, they will then start to die. So in a human, instead of 98.6, if you had a 102 degree fever, imagine like for a day or two, you know, you have a bad day, but imagine having a fever like that for a week or a month or 2 months. People are going to feel really, really bad at the end of 2 months with a 102 degree fever nonstop.
And some may not survive.
And some may not survive, right?
And that's really, that's a 2 degree centigrade difference.
Correct. Yeah, and that's the zone that most scientists have studied and have seen confirmed around the planet. Any of those coral reefs, if you push them beyond their average temperature, beyond their summer average temperatures and maximum temperature, that's where you start to see these changes. And that's this phenomenon of coral bleaching that's happening around the planet. It's a summer phenomenon. So in the peak of the summer, just imagine it's the hottest days of the summer, and now that just gets a little bit hotter than it used to get. And we saw it starting in the 80s, it continued in the 90s and the 2000s, and now from 2015 to 2017, we've seen the biggest coral bleaching event in history. It was the longest, most widespread, most damaging, simply because the oceans have continued to get warm and warm and warm. The ocean is absorbing the vast majority of the energy trapped on the planet by climate change. So as we're emitting fossil fuels into the atmosphere, as we emit carbon into the atmosphere, it's basically this blanket of our atmosphere. This blanket is collecting more heat, and 93% of that heat is getting absorbed into the ocean itself. So sometimes when people, it's hard to think about climate change, it's hard to visualize it, and when you think about, the air temperature can fluctuate a huge amount on a day-to-day basis. Yes, that is the air, but the water is absorbing so much of that heat, that water temperature is rising, and it's that same as if our body temperature was going up. That's what's happening to the entire ocean right now.
So what's happening when you look at the data is that the average ocean temperatures are moving beyond, and certainly they're spiking, beyond that sweet spot
Correct.
For coral.
Yeah.
And once they spike, because coral gets stressed, they bleach. And then if that temperature continues long enough, they die. What's fascinating in your documentary is that it doesn't take that long for them to die. This isn't a multi-year process.
I think that was one of the things that both myself, our team, and the scientists that we've been working with that surprised us the most, because we saw healthy coral reefs die in a matter of 2 months. And you can look at the images at the end of that process, and those corals look like they've been dead for years. I mean, it doesn't look like it was a quick, short-term process. But that's what we were seeing. In a matter of weeks to months, and on average around 2 months, you would see these entire ecosystems get destroyed.
Tell me a little bit more about bleaching in the clip we're going to look at right now.
Yeah. In this clip, this was the first time that Richard, one of the main subjects in the film, the first time that he really saw bleaching firsthand. And it is remarkable. When you're used to diving on a coral reef and you're used to seeing beautiful colors on the corals and you're used to seeing all this life, and you go down on a reef and everything is pure white, it's this alarm that's going off. Something is wrong. And that, when Richard saw that, he knew that there was something going on there, and that's really what set this whole quest in motion.
All right, we're going to take a look at it right now.
I was truly shocked by what I saw. The reef was white as far as the eye could see. To be honest, I didn't have the knowledge to know how to process it. Was this dead? Was it alive? This is Airport Reef. Before, so this is in December. And that's it now.
When Richard saw that white coral, it was a turning point for him. I think I admitted to him that I thought this was far more deadly than some of the other things that are facing reefs. And so what we've seen since the early 1980s when this first occurs, we've actually lost an enormous amount of coral just due to this phenomenon alone. I think that was the first time that he saw the enormity of the issue.
So what are the implications? Because I think most of us know very little about coral or the degree to which this change is happening. And just in the last few years, the devastation which has occurred, in fact, since you've produced the movie, is extraordinary. Talk a little bit about that.
This was one of the biggest shockers for me, and especially coming from the last one we did, I thought I knew everything there was to know about climate change. And really going through this process, it's much worse than I thought. So there is some sad news on that front. Based on the current projections, based on the inertia in the system, based on how much heat has been trapped by the ocean, we're on path to lose, arguably, either the vast majority to all of the coral reefs around the planet by 2050. And we're talking like in 30 years or so, we're on path to lose coral reefs as we know them. The only corals that will survive will be in little pockets in isolated places, or coral reefs that humans actively are intervening and working to protect.
How do you protect a coral reef?
Yeah, so there are a lot of different stressors. Just think of if you have a friend who's really sick when they get a fever, they're not going to do as well as somebody who's really healthy when they get a fever. So there are many stressors affecting reefs. Reefs are getting overfished. A huge thing is fertilizer runoff from upstream. So farms and agriculture using fertilizers that wash down the river valleys that go into the ocean. Now those fertilizers are really good for growing plants on land, and they grow algae in the water. And all that nitrogen causes these algal blooms to pop up, and it suffocates the coral reefs. So there are entire dead zones in the ocean right now, particularly in the Gulf of Mexico as well, where there's just very little life going on, and the corals are dying very actively because of that. So if you eliminate all those other stressors, if you're only eating very sustainable fish, if we're not eating fish that are coming off of coral reefs, if they're not getting overfished, if we have our agricultural practices in better shape where we don't have agricultural runoff killing these corals as well, there are a lot of things that we can do to protect the reefs. One great example is looking at the Florida Keys compared to Cuba. And these reefs are about 90 miles apart. But somebody took Castro on a snorkel trip one day, and he saw how beautiful the corals were, and he said, let's protect all of this. And they limited the fishing. They eliminated all the usage. They really were careful about how the reef was going to get used. And I mean, it's some of the healthiest coral that I've seen in the entire Caribbean. Huge fish, big populations, a really healthy, thriving coral reef. And you compare that to the Florida Keys, which has been devastated over the last few decades. There's very, very little coral left in the Keys. And so that's one very simple example, not far from each other geographically, but how the local practices have affected the reef are very tremendous.
So what percentage of Florida's coral have we lost? What's the estimate?
It's like 80 or 90%. I mean, it's up there. We've lost most of the corals in Florida, and people aren't really seeing that. It's the scuba divers and the fishermen. And the fishermen, the size of fish that the Florida, you can look at these historical competitions for fishermen, who brings in the biggest fish every year. And you can look at these prizes. Well, the prize-winning fish have shrunken consistently over the last decades or so. And we're just overfishing, and we're hurting these ecosystems.
All right, we're going to take our last break. We'll be back with Jeff in just a moment. I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. I very much would like to hear from you about the program, so please send me an email with your thoughts. You can suggest what topics I should cover, what guests I should invite to be on the show, or even what specific questions you would like me to ask. This is your program, so send your suggestions to Aaron@harbertv.com. I promise to personally read every one, so email me today. And most of all, thanks for watching. I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. You can follow the show on Twitter for instant notification of new episodes, live event invitations, outtakes, and behind-the-scenes photos. And tweet us your topic and guest suggestions today. Hi, I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. Because I've never done endorsements or commercials, people ask, how are our programs funded? Especially because we provide them as a public service to all our broadcast outlets. It's expensive to produce our show, whether we do them here in Denver or go to places such as Aspen, Washington, D.C., or even Iraq. The answer is we depend on contributions to support our work to bring you some of the nation's top opinion leaders. Individuals, businesses, foundations, and other nonprofits make tax-deductible contributions to the Democracy and Media Education Foundation to help allow us to continue to work for you. To find out more or to make a donation, just go to dmefd.org. The DMEF is a tax-exempt public charitable organization and has promised to dedicate 100% of every contribution to support our public affairs initiatives. If you believe, as I do, in the need for a forum which promotes civil discourse and mutually respectful discussion, I hope you'll decide to make a contribution today.
Join me and watch The Aaron Harber Show.
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 I'm Reverend Jesse Jackson. Watch The Aaron Harber Show and keep hope alive.
I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. Find us on Facebook to get all the latest updates, see behind-the-scenes photos, and make comments and ask me questions. You can see episodes before their TV broadcast, so like the show today. Welcome back to the show. We're talking about chasing coral. So, Jeff, what role does coral play in our lives that most people don't know about, either directly or indirectly?
Yeah, they are, in many ways, I look at them as the backbone of the ocean. So the entire health of the ocean is dependent on the health of coral reefs. Like we were saying, they serve as the nursery for about a quarter of life in the ocean. And they're really an integral part of this whole system. The oceans create the vast majority of the oxygen that we breathe. Right? So having a healthy ocean seems to be a really, really valuable thing. But separate from that, coral reefs, they call it the Great Barrier Reef, and that word barrier is so significant. It is a physical barrier on the edge of a coast. And when storms happen, that reef breaks down 90% of the energy of the water coming rushing in before it hits land. So it serves this huge function for protecting coasts. They feed, I forget what the estimates are, it's like 500 million to 1 billion people depend on protein coming out of reefs for their own food. So it might not necessarily be us where we are in Colorado right now, depending on that reef for a fish we might be eating. But for low-lying island nations, this is the main source of protein for many, many people on the planet. Food security is probably one of the biggest questions around the threats facing the ocean right now. What happens when 1 billion people lose a main source of protein? Right, that's not exactly a good optimistic future. But another really interesting thing is that they're finding all sorts of new drugs and chemicals that come out of different creatures on the reef as well. So there are some sponges that have chemicals in them that are being used as treatments for cancer. And we're seeing more and more. It is this living pharmacopoeia of diversity and crazy creatures that we don't understand fully, and yet we're losing them actively right now through this process.
So let's talk also about the making of the film and the impact of the film. Mm-hmm. When you made Chasing Ice, mm-hmm. what kind of impact do you feel that had on those subjects? And yeah. And what are your hopes for Chasing Coral?
Right. I think the biggest goal for us, it's this privilege but also a responsibility to be out there in the field. And I wanted to be a world environmental photographer. I wanted to be a National Geographic photographer growing up. I just wanted to go on these adventures and see the planet and get to see the beauty of this planet. And through that process and through meeting all these experts that we've come across, it went from this somewhat personally motivated adventure lifestyle to seeing just how drastically these ecosystems are changing. That's what we saw with Chasing Ice, and that's what we've seen with Chasing Coral. The planet is changing very, very quickly. And unless you go to those places, you probably don't see that, and you probably don't know just how much they're changing. So in many ways, it's our hope to be that messenger. We're going out there, we're capturing these stories that people don't get to see firsthand, and bringing them back home so that everybody can now understand what the scientists are studying out in the field. These ecosystems are the front line of climate change. This is where we're seeing changes happening the most and the fastest right now. And unfortunately, if we don't take action, it's just going to continue. We're going to lose more ecosystems. It's not going to stop with glaciers and with coral reefs. We're already losing mangroves. We're already losing seagrass meadows. We're seeing the ocean change. We already know that agricultural patterns are changing. We know that fish populations are changing where they're living. We're seeing animals migrate. Some of these things might be bad, some of them might not be bad, but we don't know where they stop. And if we don't take action on this, it will continue to be this domino effect. I'm very hopeful. I am, actually, despite what our team has seen, I am very hopeful, in part because it's so bad, right? Because these problems are getting so bad, they have gotten to the point where they are completely undeniable. We are losing coral reefs at a rate that has never been naturally recorded. This is not a part of a natural cycle. And if we can help provide this imagery for the public to see what's going on, then hopefully it opens somebody's mind to maybe there is something here, maybe there is some truth to what's going on here.
Well, some of the data that you present, and I thought the presentation of data mm-hmm. and some of the graphics
were
extremely well done.
Yeah. It's always fun and a challenge.
Easy for me to understand, great. Which that's key. And there's also a human story
yeah.
in terms of the folks, you and others involved.
Yeah,
talk just a little bit about that, including,
yeah.
you know, everyone loves the coral nerd as well.
Zach,
you know, talk about
absolutely.
Zach a little bit.
Yeah. I think the way we looked at this is, what are the kinds of films that I like to watch, that our team likes to watch? If there's a human story there, that's the most engaging. We didn't want this to be a lecture. You know, this is not designed to be a series of talking heads preaching a message. That's not at all what this film is. This is a human adventure story where we follow Richard and Zach and this team as we go out and explore what's happening to the ocean. And hopefully, if you can see the coral reefs through Zach's eyes, through Richard's eyes, you can feel how much they care about these ecosystems, then hopefully the audience can understand, wait a second, like maybe I should care about that too. Maybe there's something more to it than I thought.
Well, and some of the time-lapse photography is,
yeah.
is really fantastic.
Cool. Thank you.
And in fact, I mean, it's just worth watching the movie to see the coral, to see the luminescence
yeah.
As well. And yeah. I'm just amazed at the commitment of the
oh,
team
yeah. mm-hmm.
when something went wrong, when
yep.
they needed the time-lapse
yep.
photography.
Yep.
And they're going out every day?
Every day.
For, 107 days or some ridiculous number?
We spent 3.5 years making the film. There was a period where Zach and I were on the Great Barrier Reef. It was supposed to be a 2-month-long trip, then we were supposed to come home. And the changes that we were there to capture kept evolving, kept changing. And we just had to extend the trip longer and longer and longer, and it turned into 3 months, and it turned into 4 months. And our producers are like, hey, you guys gonna come back home anytime soon? And we knew we needed to keep capturing it to get the full story there. And it was tough. It was tough at times. But we knew that there was a greater purpose to what we were doing. And we knew that if we were successful in what we were trying to do, that hopefully it would all come together in the film, and then people would understand why this team cared so much.
Well, it's an amazing film. Congratulations.
Thanks so much. Yeah, really appreciate it.
You bet. All right, that was Jeff Orlowski. Make sure you watch Chasing Coral. It's on Netflix. So if you're not a Netflix subscriber, I guess you have to become one or know someone who is. I'm Aaron Harber. Thanks for watching. Thank you.